Welcome to a new Team CGC 9.8 video. So today I got a full list of some sleeper CGC 9.8 comics with the most long-term upside. And I had recently did a video of some of the more obvious big key issues that I thought had the most long-term upside. So yeah, be sure to check out that video if you haven't. I'll throw up the link here. But today, going over some of the more not so obvious ones that I still think make great comic book investments in the CGC 9.8. So let's have a look at the first one here. I do have this one, luckily. All right, it's a Batman Vengeance of Bane special, number one. Origin and first appearance of Bane on this one. And yeah, if you're a Batman fan, this is just a modern to focus on for sure. And I think Batman villains, like the first appearances of the Batman villains, they make a lot of sense, you know, if you're a Batman fan and even from an investment perspective, I think. And in the modern age here, you know, this is one-to-one, I think. And yeah, when you think about Batman villains, you know, in the Silver Age, like Poison Ivy book, the first Poison Ivy, the first Scarecrow it is there, and even in the Golden Age, like first Mr. Zero, you know, those are all just trending nicely and have been good comic book investments, I think, over time. And first appearance of Bane here in the 9.8, I think, is trending pretty nice too. And there's a lot of value there. You got a long-term time horizon on this one. I think it's a great one to have. 981 CGC 9.8s in the blue label. So a one of 981's pretty great for, you know, this is kind of a mid to early 90s book. And, you know, first Carnage, for example, there's like 3,000 and something of them in the 9.8. You know, first big villain here, DC villain, Bane, Carnage, pretty similar, 981 of these. So almost a better collector item than, you know, some of these Marvel villains, I would say. 32.6%, the CGC 9.8 percentage. So of all graded copies, 32.6% of them are CGC 9.8s in the blue label. Not too bad. Maybe you like to see that a bit lower, but it keeps the price somewhat reasonable. So seeing a few of these sell. One was for $366 in the CGC 9.8 white pages. I think that's a great deal right now. That was an auction price just in the last week or two. And saw another one go for $450. Yeah, so that's kind of the range. You're really patient on this one. You get it closer to $350. Maybe they're getting up to $450, which I think is completely justified. Origin and first, like Bane is a big first appearance and, you know, a villain that's going to be around for a super long time and it's going to be well collected for a really long time. So, you know, Batman villains in the modern age here, we'll kind of do a two for one for the first pick here. I'll talk about Detective Comics 583 really quick. This one's the first appearance of Scarface and the Ventriloquist. A pretty cool, psychotic, weird Batman villain. And a really collectible cover, too, by Mike Mignola, this cover. Yeah, super collectible cover. A lot of people like the cover alone. Get that first appearance in there. And yeah, Scarface and the Ventriloquist is that sort of the gangster dummy and the possessed ventriloquist with the circle glasses holds him. So super creepy. I like the whole idea of Scarface and the Ventriloquist being a super weird Gotham villain. But that's another one to consider a little bit more under the radar. There's only like 200 or 300 of them in the 9.8, and I think people are starting to pay around $300 to $400 for Detective 583. And yeah, for Batman Vengeance of Bane, there's a little bit more of them in the 9.8. It's way more popular than Detective 583. But let's call it kind of $366 to $450 for a Batman Vengeance of Bane, which I think is totally worth it. A lot of upside here if you got a long-term time horizon, I think. Okay, next one is one I don't have. It's a Spider-Man number one. Talking about the polybagged newsstand version of Spider-Man number one. Classic Todd McFarlane cover, super well collected. I feel like this one's kind of just the sweet spot for, you know, I'm still seeing like some really cheap prices in the CGC 9.8. But, you know, it just seems like a way better collector item than buying like the first print in the 9.8 for, you know, usually they're about $100 or something like that. So let's have a look on the census and some of the prices here for the newsstand polybagged version of Spider-Man number one. 194 9.8s. They do separate it on the newsstand, which is nice. One of 194 is looking pretty cool for, you know, Spider-Man number one collector item if you're a big fan of this cover. 27.8%, the 9.8 percentage. Not too bad either. Yeah, that's, you know, pretty decent for an early 90s book, this one. Mention the prices. So this newsstand polybag version saw a few sell. I think this was in December because, you know, there's only 194 of them. I wasn't seeing very many sales. 125.27, though, one went in an auction. I think another one, I'm pretty sure it was from the same seller. I didn't write that one down, but I'm pretty sure it was like 130, you know, right around that price, basically. And that was about 2 months ago. You know, newsstands are pretty hot right now. I feel like this one might even be worth paying up to 200 for. If you're just the biggest Spider-Man number one fan, you get a little bit more of a rare version here in this newsstand polybag version. I could just imagine this one being like 400 or 500 at some point, you know, in the future. And, you know, there's that gold edition UPC code one. And I think that one is like $1,000 or something like that. I'm not too on top of the Spider-Man number ones. It's one I've known, I saw it so much as a young kid, and I had them as a young kid. So it was almost not something to reach for. So I don't really collect the Spider-Man number ones, to be honest. But I think this newsstand polybag version, if you can get it under 150, amazing. If you can get it even under 200, I almost think it's worth it. The one of 194 for this one. I think, yeah, if you got long-term time horizon, it's got some good upside. All right, next one, a pretty underfollowed one, but, you know, maybe still a big key issue, kind of pushing the sleeper title here, but it's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, number 51 in the CGC 9.8. First appearance of Jennika in this one. I really like this first print cover of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, number 51. So, yeah, you know what? That big edition, the fifth edition to the Ninja Turtle, the first female Ninja Turtle, too. I just think this is one to want. I got three of these in the 9.8, and I bought mine when there was like, you know, 10 or 20 of them in the 9.8 on the census. I always thought right from the beginning, like, this is one to kind of want, that, you know, big addition to the Ninja Turtles for sure. Have a look on it. There's a lot of other things to like about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 51 too. On the census, 132, 9.8s in the blue label. So, yeah, IDW, you love that, where, you know, a little bit less printed, especially this book particularly. I don't think anyone really knew this was like first Jennika coming out, so they weren't like heavily ordering it at all. So that's one of the reasons why I think there's some good upside to this one if you got a long-term time horizon. 77.6% of all graded copies are CGC 9.8s in the blue label. Not too bad. You like to see that a bit lower, but it's more about the one of 132 for first Jennika in the best grade. This one's trending so nicely in the prices. Yeah, you know, about a year and a half ago, I purchased mine. One was like $78 or something like that. One was $100, and I think one was like $110. And seeing some completed sales here. One was for $405 in the CGC 9.8. Another one for $489.99. I think that's the range there. Yeah, you know, maybe a little bit under $400 if you're patient. $489.99 if you want it now. But, you know, you'd think, oh, well, there's, you know, probably can't go up more or something like that. But when you think about, like, Spider-Gwen, I do sort of compare this book to, you know, Spider-Gwen, a really, like, a new female Spider-Man that just totally caught on for good reason, too. Super cool and in the movie and everything. But I think, you know, first female addition to the Ninja Turtles is really similar to that. And the thing about 51 here, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 51, whereas Edge of Spider-Verse number 2 for Spider-Gwen has like 2,000 and something in the 9.8. This one has 132. So it's like a better collector item overall. So, you know, with this one at 400 and 450 and Spider-Gwen, the Edge of Spider-Verse 2 book at 1,200 in the 9.8 or something like that, you know, maybe there's some more upside. I think it makes sense that you know, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, a good one to go after. And check out the retailer incentive edition of this one, too. It's like a sketch version Eastman cover. That's a pretty cool one to think about if you're really serious about this book. I think it's a little bit more. Maybe looking at, you know, $500 to $600 for that one. All right, we'll move on here. Next one, just a fantastic collector item. It's a Malibu Sun 13 in the CGC 9.8. This is sort of the first appearance of Spawn in a promo, this Malibu Sun promo magazine, basically. And he's on the cover, on the back cover, Spawn 2, and there's a promo inside. It's a super cool one in the 9.8. You know, a couple people on the team have it, and yeah, I'm pretty jealous of them, to be honest, because one of 29 in the 9.8 blue label, so... Yeah, just that crisp blue label, how I like them. A 1 of 29 is sounding awesome to me. Even better, of all graded copies in the blue label, 9.1% of them are CGC 9.8. So a single digit 9.8 ratio is unheard of almost in the 90s. This is a 90s book. So, you know, it's relatively rare. There's only 1 of 29. So from all angles, this one's looking great. Wasn't seeing any completed listings on eBay. being there's only 29 out there, it's hard to see this one sell. GoCollect got the value at 1,500 in the blue label. So I think if you can do 1,500, it's pretty much worth it. Yeah, especially given how some books have really increased in value. I wouldn't be surprised if under 2,000 is tough to do on a Malibu 13 right now. This was one where I had almost a year ago now, I put it on a want list, and I was really kind of focusing on getting it, and it was about 800, 700, and this was about a year ago, so yeah, maybe February of last year. Didn't really follow through searching for it too much, and it, you know, started seeing sales at like 1,300, and then didn't end up buying this one, but such a great collector item, one of 29. In the blue label, and just predating Spawn number one. I sort of prefer Spawn number one newsstand maybe a little bit more. It's easier to find and it's less expensive, so I got one of those, and I kind of want another one, to be honest. But yeah, well, Malibu Sun 13, you got a long-term time horizon on this one. You got the one of 129, or I think there's about 100 signature series ones of this one, with, you know, Todd McFarlane signing a lot of them, so that might be a way to go too. But you got a long-term time horizon. There's not a lot of these. It's going to be a great one, and I think it'll increase in value steadily. All right, next one here is maybe one not too many people think about too much. It's a Silver Surfer 44 in the CGC 9.8. Kind of kept it in the plastic here. Hopefully you can see it, just because I was leaning up another book here. But this one is the first appearance of Infinity Gauntlet. So the Infinity Gauntlet, I think, is, you know, you kind of got some, you know, people not really liking this book or not really collecting it, thinking that, oh, it's not really a first appearance, it's, you know, a first appearance of a weapon, like, you know, how is that even a first appearance type of thing. And I actually sort of take the other end of that argument pretty much for Silver Surfer 44. It's a pretty great collector item in the 9.8, we'll get to that, but I just think all these kids seeing the Avengers movies and the Guardians of the Galaxy movies in the last 10 years with the Infinity Gauntlet like so prominent, you know, in about 10 to 15 years they're going to grow up, have really good jobs, and I think Infinity Gauntlet's just going to be, first appearance of Infinity Gauntlet's going to be one that's super collected over time. And trending pretty nicely in price in the 9.8, we'll have a look here. There's a 281 CGC 9.8s in the blue label. That's not a lot for, like, you know, first appearance. Given that the Infinity Gauntlet's been in all these movies, you'd think there'd be like 1,000 of them or something. But it's an early 90s book too, so this is, I got two of them in the 9.8. yeah, and this is one I've kind of targeted as, you know, wow, only 281 of them with a really high potential, I think, first appearance of Infinity Gauntlet. So 23.3%, the 9.8 ratio in the blue label. Not too bad at all for an early 90s book. Yeah, like a 1 of 281 with that ratio. It's looking great on the census pretty much for a 90s book. So one selling here for $374.99. Another one for $395. So I think that's right in the fair value range for this one right now. And if you got a long-term time horizon for this one, for all those reasons there, just, you know, Infinity Gauntlet in pop culture so much in the last 10 years here, I bet this one's going to be really collected over time. And given where some 9.8s have went in price, like $375 for a Silver Surfer 44 9.8 is sounding like a great value, I think. All right, next one up here, I got one, absolutely, it's a Batman 423 in the CGC 9.8. Yeah, one of those under the radar non-key issues that's trending pretty nicely in the 9.8 for sure. But I'm a big Batman fan and a Todd McFarlane fan, and this is kind of the coolest Todd McFarlane Batman cover, and it's a great collector item in the 9.8 as well. Having a look here on the census, Batman 423, 142 CGC 9.8s in the blue label, so a 1 of 142. I got two of them in the 9.8. Yeah, I picked up two of them like 2 years ago now. Just, yeah, being a big Batman and McFarlane fan, it was kind of one I wanted right away. But we'll get into the prices because they are trending nicely. But if you got this one, like a 1 of 142 in the blue label is a great feeling. 14%, the 9.8 ratio, which is great for like a late 80s book. It's awesome. You know, it's not single digit. It's not getting to where, you know, oh, now it's going to be $3,000 because it's so rare in the 9.8. But a decent investment grade rarity for a late 80s book, this one. Late 80s, not early 80s. That's really similar to kind of early 80s 9.8 ratios, to be honest, of, you know, big investment grade books that are really expensive. So Batman 423, seeing quite a few sell, and mostly from the same seller for $1,200 lately. Yeah, there's this one seller, you can kind of tell this pictures all look the same, like they're taking them in the same spot. And I don't know if he has multiples of this one in the 9.8, but they're selling pretty consistently for $1,200. I think if you're really patient in an auction, I believe they were sort of a buy it nows. So if you're really patient in an auction, you might get this one, you know, 1,100, 1,080 or something like that. But I think this one's probably over 1,000, being that there's not too many of them out there and it's super collected. A lot of McFarlane fans out there, and he didn't do Batman very much at all. So this is by far the coolest McFarlane Batman cover, in my opinion. So, yeah, if you got a long-term time horizon, there's not a lot of them out there, it's still going to be bought. Again, 2 years ago, purchased mine, right about $400. I think one was $450. And they had sort of dipped down there like a year and a half ago to sort of, I remember seeing some for like $340 in auctions go for. And now $1,200. So the trend is kind of your friend on this one, and it kind of makes sense given that there's so many McFarlane fans and there's only 142 of these, so the supply is tight. And yeah, it kind of makes sense. Okay, our next one here is one I've been talking about for quite a while as a bit of a sleeper up-and-comer. Still want to stick with it though. Oh, Wolverine 88 in the CGC 9.8. Yeah, I got three of these in the 9.82. This is I'm really nostalgic for this cover. Growing up in the 90s, collecting comic books, I really love this cover. This was like a key issue to me when I was growing up as a kid. Even though I didn't know this was like the first time Wolverine and Deadpool fight. I didn't really know that. So you know, just a cover that was really favorable. And yeah, usually when you get, you know, like a pretty seminal moment in comics, Wolverine versus Deadpool for the first time, mixed in with a really great cover, that's pretty cool. It's one to collect, and I still think it is. Unfortunately, the prices are getting a little expensive. I think the Deadpool 3 movie coming out, there's like a whole nother level to some of the prices, unfortunately. So you might want to be patient on it. 105 9.8s out there. They just started, maybe about a year or two ago, on the census, notifying the deluxe edition for this one. And they're really very similar. The non-deluxe edition, which is more rare, just doesn't say deluxe here. And it's got a bit of a different price. I think it's like 50 cents less. That's why they, usually if the price is different, they'll differentiate it on the census. So I just lump them all together in the 9.8 because for years and years they were not differentiating them. So it's a confusing census for Wolverine 88. But there's 105 9.8s in the blue label overall, some being the more rare non-deluxe version. All the ones I have are deluxe version. They're the kind of cheapest version of this one, but still, like, super cool. If you do, you know, hunt down that non-deluxe one, if you're the biggest fan of a Wolverine 88, for sure. 46.1% of all graded copies are 9.8, so not a heavily graded one. Maybe like to see that a bit lower, but some of the recent prices for this one, I saw one sell for $449.95. I think still under 400 is doable on this one. I think occasionally you're getting people in there excited about Wolverine and Deadpool, you know, paying over 400 for this one maybe. Or, you know, that Deadpool movie. And I don't know, I haven't really heard any rumors that, you know, Wolverine's going to fight Deadpool in Deadpool 3, but people are speculating on that possibly, plus just the coolness of the book, you know, as I mentioned there. So hopefully you get it under 400, or maybe check out some raw copies for sure. This is probably one you can maybe find, you know, in the bins at, you know, at your local shop for pretty cheap. So, you know, you might want to go that route. But Wolverine 88 is a kind of a sleeper that I think, you know, I've done well on it. The trend has been, yeah, one of them I bought for, it was like $52 in the 9.8. And then the other two I bought right around $100. And this was like 2 years ago. And oh, the most recent one though I bought, it was $145 or $150. So yeah, I got a really good deal, then about 100, then 145. Now they're 400-ish, so that's the trend is, well, you know, going good in this one. And I think it'll continue, but you might want to, you know, wait for definitely under $400 in the CGC 9.8. Kind of a tough one to recommend, given that it's really just exploded in price recently. Okay, a little last one here of a great sleeper CGC 9.8 comic that I think still has a lot of long-term upside. It's Ultimate Spider-Man number one in the CGC 9.8. This one is the first Ultimate title, and I do like this one in the first print because it's pretty rare in the 9.8. It's got a nice relative rarity, that 9.8 ratios nice and low for a modern book, and there's not too many of them either. Ultimate Spider-Man number one, 412, 9.8s in the blue label. So this is like the first Ultimate title, which, you know, the Ultimate title leads into Miles Morales and everything like that. So I think there's a good reason that this will be very well collected over time. It's got a big cult of following already. And in this sort of first print with that red sidebar down the side, it's pretty tough in the 9.8. Of all graded copies in the blue label, 14.2% of all graded copies are CGC 9.8. Like, yeah, again, you know, into the low teen, or into the teens, I guess you could say, for a late 90s book. Pretty much a modern book here when everyone knew to kind of keep their book in a bag and board and stuff like that. And I think a lot of these books where it's like a simple color down the one side really shows like the spine ticks pretty much. So there's that too, probably keeping this one pretty tough in the 9.8, but it's a great one to think about. And I, you know, really thought of putting this one on the list again because I just saw a recent completed listing in an auction for $202.50. That I think is one of the better values out there in 9.8 comics right now, you know, given that, you know, there's a lot of key issues out there, like right around $1,000. Star Wars key issues are really hot, you know, for good reason, a lot of them. But this one here for $202.50, I think, whoever bought that, that's a fantastic buy. I did have this one on sort of, yeah, I recommended it on definitely a few videos here in the last 6 months. It's one that surprised me in the 9.8 when I looked on the census at how rare it was. And first Ultimate title, yeah, I think this one right around 200 if you can pull that off. I would even pay up to 250 for this one in the 9.8, given how good it looks on the census. And I think first Ultimate title will be collected for the long term. So a great one to think about with, you know, some long-term upside in mind. All right, a full list there. Yeah, okay, I think we got through nine of them with that two-for-one with the Batman villains at the beginning in the 9.8. But yeah, you know, these are still pretty big key issues, but again, check out that other video there where I talked about a lot of the main, you know, a lot of the ones, admittedly, that have the most long-term upside are big, super huge key issues. I already did that in the other video, but this one, some more underfollowed ones that are maybe a little bit cheaper too, but still have, I think, some great long-term upside potential. And that's, you know, that's kind of the philosophy of the whole channel here is, you know, I don't like flipping books. I've pretty much never sold any 9.8 I've had. Yeah, I don't sell anything really, not yet anyway. And so, yeah, you know, I'm really taking that long-term time horizon, and it's worked so far. You know, haven't, you know, started buying these about 3-4 years ago, I guess, and haven't sold anything. And, you know, the prices are really trending nicely given coronavirus and everything that's happened. But I'm still, you know, thinking about holding these for like 10 or 20 more years, to be honest. So, all right. Thanks so much for watching. Really appreciate all the support from the team. If you haven't already, though, I would invite you to join the team and subscribe to Team CGC 9.8. Yeah, I would love to have you on our comic book collecting and comic book investing team. Hit the bell for all the latest notifications. Add me on Instagram and Twitter, too. All the links in the description below. But yeah, hopefully you got some ideas here. Yeah, just some, you know, classic ones that I bought in the 9.8. I felt I wanted to have them because I do think a lot of these sleepers have some good long-term upside. Okay, thanks again, team, so much. And I'll see you on the next one.